The Soviet scientists trying to get chimps pregnant with human babies, the university building that transformed into a sadistic prison, and the scientific screwdriver accident that caused one of the most painful deaths in history. And that is just the beginning. Dust off your lab coats and grab your goggles, we're going to need them. On today's episode of The Infographic Show, insane science experiments that went horribly wrong. Number 10. We begin our journey into the horrifying world of mad science with Carl August Vinhold, a self-styled scientist who wanted to raise the dead in the early 1800s. But reanimation wasn't even the weirdest thing on his resume. His fellow scientists at the time thought he was a total creep for his quote revolutionary plan to end poverty. He wanted to surgically clamp down every poor man's foreskin to stop them from having more poor kids. But he wasn't just a menace to the wieners of the poor, he had it out for cats too. He became obsessed with galvanic electric shocks inspired by Luigi Galvani, an Italian scientist who discovered in 1780 that frogs' legs would twitch when zapped with electricity. Vinhold took that discovery and he ran with it, straight into the uncanny valley of scientific horror. Carl removed the spinal cord of a deceased cat, replacing it with a mix of copper and zinc, essentially turning the kitty corpse into a furry little battery, and then he put an electrical current into this crime against nature and claimed that it was returned to life, hobbling around the room until he turned off the juice. Scientists roundly agreed that Vinhold made that up, seeing as even his contemporaries in the field thought he lived in a fantasy world, and we are feeling pretty eager to leave Vinhold's mind as quickly as we can. Number 9. Surprisingly, there's a lot of scientists throughout history who wanted to test whether a human head could be revived by pumping new blood into it, and the actual experiments were somehow even freakier than that suggests. It all started in France, home of the guillotine, where scientists began to ponder just how long a human head survived after being sliced from its shoulders. And one of those scientists was Dr. Jean-Baptiste Vincent Laborde. Back in 1884, Laborde wasn't just passionate about science, he was ready to put his own body on the line for it. As a member of a social group called the Society of Mutual Autopsy, he consented to have some of his best friends cut up and study his body when he died. And even before he died, he was eager to give that treatment to other people, specifically the severed heads of executed criminals. First came a murderer named Campi. His head was brought to Dr. Laborde an hour after he was killed, and the doctor pumped blood through it. The results were unimpressive. Laborde blamed that on the fact that the head had taken too long to be delivered after Campi was given the chop. His next subject was a freshly severed criminal head belonging to a man named Gagne, delivered 7 minutes after execution. This time, Laborde went full mad scientist. He connected the head to the still pumping carotid artery of a living dog, causing the facial muscles to contract and the jaws to snap shut. That is undeniably pretty nasty. But Laborde looked like a member of Greenpeace compared to his friend and colleague, Dr. Paul Loya. He experimented on post-decapitation vital signs by building his own miniature guillotine and using it on hundreds of dogs. But the real scientific frontier in dog zombies didn't expand until the 1920s, when Soviet scientist Sergei Brukhonenko invented a blood-pumping machine that he called the autojector. With the help of some anticoagulant drugs, he used the autojector to keep a dog's head alive for 3 hours. The proto-pooch responded to stimuli and even ate food placed into its mouth, which promptly fell out the other end. But that is nowhere near the weirdest, freakiest experiment that the Soviets have performed. Number 8. Dr. Ilia Ivanov, to put it bluntly, was a certified freak, 7 days a week. He wasn't concerned with reanimating corpses or messing around with pets. No, Dr. Ivanov wanted to breed the first ever human Z. And that is exactly what it sounds like, a human-chimpanzee hybrid. This wasn't an attempt to build a race of super soldiers for the Russian military. The real goal behind these bizarre experiments was ideological. The USSR and its allies believed that proving humans and chimps could still interbreed and produce viable offspring would be incontrovertible proof of Darwinian evolution. It would be a win in the culture war when American religious conservatives were pushing back against evolutionary science. So, what was the experimental method for finding out whether humanzees would even work? Well, first Dr. Ivanov and his son headed over to French Guinea to find as many female chimps as possible. Packed in Ivanov's hand luggage was a container of human sperm and an insemination tool. His son was armed with a handgun just in case the chimps decided that they weren't on board with the plan. Despite the ethical nightmare that this plan posed, they actually managed to artificially inseminate 13 chimps. but none of the pregnancies were viable. But before you breathe a sigh of relief, Ivanov decided to flip the script. This time, he would try to inseminate a human woman with chimp sperm. He first tried asking around hospitals in countries across Africa whether they would be willing to let him secretly impregnate female patients for his chimp experiments. Unsurprisingly, they told him to get lost. Ivanov then returned to Russia and purchased a male chimp called Tarzan in the late 1920s, and now he just needed to find a willing human Jane. And in the twist of the century, Ivanov actually found a Russian woman willing to take part in the experiment. While many questioned her mental state, and understandably so, she reportedly gave full consent. But before Ivanov could move forward with his bizarre plan, tragedy, or divine intervention depending on how you look at it, struck, with Tarzan dying of a brain hemorrhage in 1929, and Dr. Ivanov's Human Z dreams died with him. Now it's time for an American innovation that somehow combines and tops everything that came before it. Number 7. While the Human Zs were a dead end, thankfully, the Russian experimental surgery community never stopped doing weird stuff with dogs. In the 1950s, Dr. Ivan Demikov shocked and fascinated the world by creating two-headed dogs. He surgically inserted the heads of puppies onto adult dogs so they would share the same circulatory system. None of these dogs ever lasted more than a month, but this did kick off a terrifyingly named surgical arms race of the Cold War. The American given the task of topping Demikov's double dogs was the Harvard-educated rock star surgeon Dr. Robert White. His Frankensteinian dream was to perfect the full head transplant. This involved removing the head of a living being, keeping it alive, and then seamlessly connecting it to another living body so it could then resume normal function. What could possibly go wrong, right? First, he needed to test that a brain could remain alive without a body, so he began with a small monkey. Bit by bit, he surgically removed the brain. Incredibly, he succeeded in keeping the brain alive, so he knew enough to move on to the next stage. Next, in the early 1960s, he needed to know whether a brain could survive in another creature's body. He removed the brain of a dog and connected it to the blood vessels in the neck of another pooch. The brain wouldn't have any control over the second dog, but it would at least remain alive for enough time to satisfy the conditions of the experiment. In 1971, after years of preparation, he did the deed on another unfortunate monkey. He transplanted the head of one monkey onto another monkey's body. He and other surgeons then did the meticulous work of reconnecting all the major blood vessels. The result was a living and terrified monkey head, capable of responding to stimuli, chewing food, and even biting Dr. White's finger when he stuck it into the monkey's mouth. The problem was, they didn't have the technology to reconnect the spine, meaning that the monkey was effectively paralyzed below the neck. With its new body doing little more than pumping blood, it died a day and a half after the surgery due to complications. This also marked the end of Dr. Robert White's serious career as a surgeon, with the general public now viewing him as a kind of monkey Mengele. But that is nowhere near the most messed up experiment conducted in the US of A. Number 6. In 1932, 600 black men in Tuskegee, Alabama got a letter from a locally, historically African-American college, the Tuskegee Institute. The letter offered them a special, one-time-only free inoculation for black blood, a local term for a variety of ailments. It seemed like a deal that was too good to be true. And that's because it was. These 600 men weren't getting treated for anything. They were all being made unknowing subjects of the Tuskegee syphilis study, one of the most infamous and unethical experiments ever performed on U.S. soil. 201 of the 600 black men had a clean bill of health. 399 of them unknowingly suffered from latent syphilis, and the study chose to treat only half of them. Over the next 40 years, they wanted to see the toll that untreated syphilis would take on these people. This meant painful, disfiguring, and debilitating symptoms, and by 1972, when the study ended, around 100 of the people involved had died. And the worst part? Penicillin was found to be an effective treatment for syphilis back in the early 1940s, so the people who were sick could have been treated if the scientists behind the study had told them what they were actually sick with. When the truth came out, they were sued for $10 million for just what a monstrous disaster this whole thing had been. But while this experimental mess had messed with the lives of 600 people, our next mad scientist worked on over 10,000 over the course of his deranged career. Number 5. Obviously, finding out that your husband had just been executed in prison for his crimes is always going to be a little surreal. One thing that might make it more surreal is getting a letter from your acclaimed mad scientist, Dr. Leo Stanley, offering to pay 10 grand if you'll let him cut off your husband's man purse. For science, of course. And this wasn't an uncommon state of affairs, because Dr. Stanley's main drag was performing bizarre experiments on the testicles of American prisoners over the course of the early 20th century. And as a chief surgeon of California's San Quentin prison, he had legions of test subjects with basically no human rights, and Dr. Stanley was having a ball at his new job. He had a theory that the inclination toward crime was rooted in the endocrine disorders, so Stanley hoped that by making adjustments to the testicles of criminals, he could relieve their drive to commit crimes, while also potentially increasing their health and virility. And what kind of adjustments are we talking about? Testicle grafting, occasionally with humans, but mainly splicing the testicles of animals like deer, boar, goats, and rams with those of his prisoners. Do we even need to tell you that it didn't reduce the rate at which they committed crimes or make them any healthier? It's also worth mentioning that Dr. Stanley was also pretty horrifically racist. He was a huge proponent of racial segregation and the pseudoscience of eugenics. It probably goes without saying that those views informed the approach that he had to his 10,000 prison subjects and their unfortunate bits. Let's take a diversion over to a man whose disastrous failed experiment only ended up destroying himself. Number 4. Over the course of his life, Frenchman Franz Reichelt had the nickname the Flying Tailor, but sadly, the insane experiment that ended his life proved that he probably should have been given the nickname the Falling Tailor. Franz was obsessed with aviation, and it was his dream to create a parachute suit for pilots to ensure that they'd always have a soft landing. An admirable goal, but the Flying Tailor's methods weren't exactly the most scientific. He tested the suit himself, resulting in a broken leg after a fall of 26 feet, but this didn't stop him. For his ultimate experiment, a filmed demonstration in front of a huge crowd in 1912, he was going to jump off of the Eiffel Tower while wearing his new suit. Despite all of his friends trying to talk him out of it, he was committed and he had faith in his designs. But the problem was he really shouldn't have had that faith. He leaped off the tower and fell to his death in front of everyone. One of the earliest human deaths caught on camera. But despite the fall only lasting a few seconds, a later autopsy confirmed that he died of a heart attack from sheer terror before he even hit the ground. Anyway, let's now take a look at an experiment that claimed to reveal the potential for evil in humanity's collective soul. Number 3. When diving into the history of insane science experiments that went horribly wrong, you will quickly realize that no branch of science is immune. Biology, physics, chemistry, even psychology have all had their skeletons in the lab closet. And few are as notorious as Philip Zimbardo's 1971 Stanford Prison Experiment. You've almost definitely heard this study referenced or cited if you've ever been interested in psychology, but there are a lot of crazy facts about it that you probably still don't know, like the fact that this study was actually funded by the U.S. Office of Naval Research. They wanted to study antisocial behavior, specifically focusing on conflicts between naval prisoners and guards. With this in mind, the study was founded on a simple question: does cruelty and violence come out of the tendencies and actions of individual people, or do the roles and power structures we exist inside dictate how we act? In order to find out, Zimbardo and his assistants made a single hallway in the basement of Stanford University into an incredibly realistic simulated prison. And then, once he recruited 24 experimental subjects, he had them randomly assigned into the roles of inmate and guard. And over the course of the experiment quickly descended into abuse and chaos, as the prisoners internalized their oppression and the guards let the power go to their heads. Even Zimbardo himself started getting wrapped up in all the excitement, going mad with all the authority that his self-given position of warden had given him. For years, it was considered an unconventional but powerful illustration of what Zimbardo called the Lucifer effect. How roles and power structures can corrupt individual human behavior. But behind the scenes, the experiment was a methodological mess. Archival footage later released showed that the guards hadn't actually been driven mad by their roles. Instead, they'd been actively coached to be abusive and hostile by the staff to create more interesting results. The suffering was real, but the circumstances were a setup, making the whole experiment completely invalid. There is at least one good thing you can say about the Stanford Prison Experiment: nobody melted. Well, sadly, you can't say that about our next series of deranged experiments. Number 2. One constant in the history of the human race is that we'll do almost anything to try to ward off death. Chinese Emperor Qin Shi Huang drank a mercury tincture prepared by his court alchemist to become immortal. He died, by the way. A man named Brian Johnson regularly receives electric shocks to his penis as a part of an extensive pseudoscientific health regimen to keep him young. But one of the most wackadoo scientific attempts to deny the Reaper his prize exists in the weird world of cryonics. This is the practice of preserving human bodies or body parts in the hope that they'll last until all human ailments, including death itself, can presumably be cured by medical technology. But something truly horrifying can happen if you make a mistake while trying to preserve human bodies for the future. When it's cryonics time, your body will be wrapped up in insulating material and then placed inside a giant metal tube filled full of liquid nitrogen called a dewar. Sometimes a single dewar will contain 4 full corpses around the outside and 5 heads in the middle. The dewar will then be placed in a large container with a vacuum seal, hoping to keep a consistent temperature. These containers will be kept en masse inside an extremely expensive temperature-controlled morgue. Of course, seeing as we're not in the future, nobody's quite figured out how to revive a cryogenically preserved body, and boy does it get disgusting when it goes wrong. Robert Nelson started one of the earliest cryonics operations in Chatsworth, California back in the 1960s. He initially kept the corpses of his patients frozen on dry ice in a morgue. That was until bad results and customer complaints forced him to transition to the dewar method. In 1974, Nelson froze a body too quickly, causing the corpsicle to crack. Monstrous mistakes like this were not an isolated incident for Nelson, and later the cooling systems in his operation failed, making the bodies heat up and rot. An even worse case popped up in Butler, New Jersey. There, a failure in the vacuum seal layer of the freezer caused the bodies to reposition in the dewar, freezing to each other and to the side of the capsule. The dewar broke again later, and this time the corpses thawed entirely, rendering them into a thick, repulsive human sludge. What's the difference between that and our next experiment, you might ask? At least in cryonics, the person is already dead first. Number 1. Unlike a lot of the experiments on this list, the experiment itself here wasn't all that horrifying. It was just another one of the huge range of tests performed under the umbrella of the Manhattan Project, America's nuclear trump card to win World War II. But one little part of those experiments will always live in infamy: the Demon Core. And with something that has a name that sinister, you know something is bound to go wrong, especially when there is a reckless researcher involved. And that researcher's name was Lewis Slotin. A Canadian physicist and one of the foremost experts on working with plutonium, Slotin was the natural choice for working on the Demon Core, a lethal, highly radioactive plutonium deposit inside a metal sphere. Slotin was undeniably extremely skilled and intelligent, but he was also cocky and impulsive. He had a habit of tickling the dragon's tail, pushing the Demon Core to the very edge of criticality, but being careful not to stray over that line to full meltdown. It involved putting a layer of beryllium called a tamper over the core, lowering it manually with a screwdriver to kickstart a nuclear reaction for the physicists present to study. It was a reaction that could be safely stopped as long as the beryllium tamper never completely covered the plutonium. But on May 21, 1946, Slotin fumbled the screwdriver, the tamper fell, and a momentary flash of blue light scorched the room, with Slotin himself taking the lion's share of the criticality burst. He had doomed not only himself, but several other people who just happened to be in the room at the time. Slotin had received 2,100 rem of neutrons, gamma rays, and X-rays from the blue flash. For context on just how utterly screwed that made him, the threshold for a fatality in humans is normally 500 rem. He died 9 days later in excruciating pain from radiation sickness, and he had to be buried in a sealed military casket to prevent radiation leakage. Now check out this experiment promised immortality. The result was horrific. Or watch this instead.